to ask you, would you please, please be mine? Whenever you came around, my heart would pound. So you must have had a hunch. So you came up to me and asked me to be yours. You beat me to the punch. One more time, you beat me to the punch.
Oh, I was going to groove to the song, Mike. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the National Museum of African American History and Culture. We are so excited that you are here to join us today for a wonderful conversation with Dr. Blair Kelley and her newest publication, Black Folk. My name is Doretha Williams. I direct the Center for the Digitization and Curation of African American History here at the museum, where we focus on highlighting local histories and emphasizing genealogy and working to nurture the next generation of museum professionals. Dr. Kelley is an award-winning author, historian, and scholar of the African American experience. A dedicated public historian, Dr. Kelley works to amplify the histories of Black people, chronicling the everyday impact of their activism. Dr. Kelley is the Joel R. Williamson Distinguished Professor of Southern Studies at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, and the incoming director of the Center for the Study of the American South. She is the first Black woman to serve in this role in the center's 30-year history. Dr. Kelley is the author of two books, including Right to Ride, Streetcar Boycotts, and African American Citizenship, and her most latest publication, Black Folk, the Roots of the Black Working Class, which draws on family histories and mines the archive to illuminate the adversities and joys of the Black working class in America. Dr. Kelley received her BA from the University of Virginia in History and African American Studies. She earned her MA and PhD in History and graduate certificates in African and African American Studies and Women's Studies at Duke University. She will be joined in conversation with Gene Demby. Gene Demby is the co-host and correspondent for NPR's Code Switch team. Before coming to NPR, he served as the managing editor for Huffington Post's Black Voices following its launch. Prior to that role, he spent 6 years in various positions at the New York Times. While working for the Times in 2007, he started a blog about race, culture, politics, and media called Post Bougie, which won the 2009 Black Weblog Award for Best News and Politics site. Please welcome in conversation Dr. Kelley and Gene Demby.
Good morning, y'all.
Good morning.
Doc, I guess we should just get right into it. So when we were talking a couple weeks ago, you were talking to me about how your mom always refers to herself as Black working folks.
Yes.
What does she mean by that?
Well, I think she was always concerned to be where she came from. Mm-hmm. So she was a school teacher, but she was first generation person in college education in her family. And she always just thought of herself as where her roots were. She mm-hmm. thought of herself in terms of her mother and her father and her grandfather mm-hmm. in North Carolina. So she never was interested in sort of creating any kind of distance between herself and everybody else. Mm-hmm. So it was a grounding for her. Mm-hmm. And so when I came to think about this, you know, of course, we think of me as, you know, elite, I guess, I don't know. Mm-hmm. I work for a state, so.
Right.
a government employee, but, it didn't feel distant. It mm-hmm. didn't feel like something I shouldn't take on.
What did her parents do?
Her parents, her mother worked as an agricultural work as a young person mm-hmm. In rural South Carolina.
What does that mean? That's a very big category.
Cotton. Mm-hmm. And they had kitchen garden mm-hmm. around their home. And so she was a very proficient gardener. She was really good at and understood plants and how to do things in the yard and when things weren't working right, and she was really keen on understanding the land and fruit, and she planted fruit trees, and I did all kinds of things. So she was really knowledgeable about that stuff. Mm-hmm. But she worked in cotton as a little one. Then her family migrates from South Carolina into Thomasville. Mm-hmm. And in Thomasville, she was able to go to school. And mm-hmm. so she was so excited about that change. And she graduated from high school, something she always did tell me about, because she was extremely proud of that. And my grandfather, John D. Duncan, was a trip.
They always are, right?
Yeah. Well, he really was. He was funny and smart and mean and could tell a mean little joke that would turn right on you if he wanted to. Mm-hmm. But he was a really big character in my mom's life. And mm-hmm. so he ran away. His mother passed away when he was a teenager. His family ran from Comer, Georgia into Thomasville. Mm-hmm. And then he ran away from his parents at 14 with his big brother, OB. And they would hobo on the trains. He told me he learned to light a cigarette on top of the train moving. That was one of his key signatures of his hobo life during the Great Depression. Mm-hmm. And so they would go and look for work. He was great with his hands. He was a carpenter. Mm-hmm. And OB was a really great mason. And so together they wanted to build stuff. And mm-hmm. that was their vision as teenagers.
They like literally worked the land.
They both got drafted into the Second World War. And OB served.
Huh.
And my grandfather went to the training camp, did the whole training camp. And they said, okay, you have some time off. Go home, visit with your family, and then we'll call you back. And they never called back. So he never went back. So he's not a veteran, but his brother served in Europe, mm-hmm. And was really proud of it. They were really hard, strong men, mm-hmm. and didn't need much to get by.
So your family thinks of itself as a working class family.
Absolutely.
How should we think about the Black working class? Like, what, when you say Black working class, what does that encapsulate?
So for me, it really is folks who work on an hourly wage, mm-hmm. or worked in rural places on seasons, who didn't have that sort of elite status. But when you think about Black life, most times elite people don't have that status.
Mm-hmm.
We have a tiny elite in Black America, like a little tiny one, mm-hmm. in any earlier period other than our own right now.
Right.
And so when you talk to most people have working class, Black working class roots.
Mm-hmm. And even when you talk about the elite, you're talking about jobs that
school teacher.
Exactly. Hairstylists. Morticians.
And for me, the hairstylists were kind of like, because some hairstylists are working class hairstylists, mm-hmm. and some people own a little shop and can get a little business going. So they're small entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. Barbers are small entrepreneurs and really influential in Black life. So mm-hmm. I didn't include them as part of what I was considering working class, mm-hmm. but a preacher mm-hmm. would be considered not working class, a professor, mm-hmm. Around HBCUs around the time, and small entrepreneurs. Most cities had like an entrepreneurial class
mm-hmm.
Amongst Black folk because of segregation, but again, never more than like 5% of mm-hmm. the population in any area around the turn of the 20th century.
But the Black working class also included people like the Pullman porters. You spent a chapter on the book about them.
Absolutely.
And they're so fascinating because you say like they're like super cosmopolitan. They were the most well-traveled Black people in America. They were going from one end to the other. They were social connectors. If you were a Black person moving to a different part of the country, they were the people you interface with to sort of give you the rules of the road, right?
Yes, absolutely.
But also like, even though they had cachet, they wore uniforms, right? They worked for tips, right?
Yes.
And so they like were both, they had like social cachet and also were very much working people.
Yeah, I think Black folks held them in very high esteem,
mm-hmm.
because of their mobility, because of the knowledge that they had about the places you might want to move and might want to go. They carried Black newspapers back and forth mm-hmm. out of the North down South so that people could read and study and where they would want to go so they could really make a clean plan.
Mm-hmm.
They helped folks network and make decisions about where to live. And I have a story in the book about a Pullman porter that helps C.L. Dellums find where he wants to go.
That's a great story.
He wants to go to San Francisco because
he's like, nah, go to Oakland.
Yeah. and he's like, no, you're not going to be able to stay anywhere in San Francisco. You need to go to Oakland.
Mm.
And he literally sets him up in an apartment on the train. And so, you know, he's a reminder of the incredible networks that Pullman porters are laying out for folks they don't even know, but that they want to support.
Mm.
And so for them, I always teach about them because they're essential to like how we know the Great Migration, how we understand, and how we did these impossible things.
Mm-hmm. And they're like central to the story of Black organized labor. Could you talk a little bit about the Brotherhood?
So the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters is this amazing union organizing that happens over decades, really comes to fruition in the 1930s in the wake of the New Deal. And the sleeping car porters really face a hard hill in organizing this union. The Pullman Company was the sleeping cars on trains. So trains were the intercontinental travel of the time. So you'd have to sleep on the train in order to go really far. And George Mortimer Pullman, an industrialist, invented the sleeping car as a luxurious and comfortable way to do this cross-country travel. And so a car would have regular seats in it during the day, and then it could be transformed into sleeping berths with little curtains, so you would have a private place to sleep. And the Pullman porters were the people in charge of those spaces.
Mm-hmm.
They basically were leased with the cars. Pullman owned the cars, and he owned the people who worked on them.
Wow.
And
he specifically wanted Black men.
He wanted Black men. He wanted it to feel like slavery.
Mm.
He wanted, you know, you'd have this manservant who was waiting on you hand and foot as you traveled. And so that sort of hearkening back was what he was going for. But he wanted those men to be educated a little bit.
But not too much.
Not too much. Mm. He wanted those men to be providing, you know, excellent, intelligent service.
Mm-hmm.
And so they were basically like little concierges on these trains for very elite passengers.
Mm-hmm.
So they had like a powerful status, but then they were limited in what they could do. They couldn't be conductors. They couldn't move up in Pullman's company. And Pullman was notorious for treating his white workers poorly.
Mm-hmm.
He certainly treated his Black workers extremely poorly.
Mm-hmm.
So when they organized the union, they were going up against a powerful juggernaut in society.
And you write about like there were all these Black people who had these working class jobs that were kind of indispensable, right? They were looked down upon.
Mm-hmm.
But because they were indispensable jobs, Black people used them as points of leverage.
Yes.
To strike.
Yes.
To organize. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit about both the Brotherhood and, this is one of the dopest stories, the Atlanta washerwoman strike of 1881.
So, you know, when Black workers have a monopoly on a set of employments, when people were just like, oh, that's Black work, that's something we don't do, Black workers were able to figure out, okay, you don't do that, I do that, so let me set the terms by which I will do that, as long as we all come together collectively. So it's really a really powerful reminder that Black workers didn't need outside union organizers to come tell them about their power. And about the labor market, they understood it innately. The Pullman porters used that. I also write about washerwomen, women who do laundry. Before the advent of washer machines, laundry was really hard to do. I mean, laundry's harder for me to do with a machine. So, you know, women who were making their own soap and boiling water and carding water and you know, using chemicals and agents, creating their own starch, ironing with an actual iron with a rag wrapped around it, you know, and really keeping whole families' clothes clean week after week. And so white women really kind of looked down on doing laundry.
Hmm.
A white woman of any status would try to not have her laundry hanging in her own yard and her out there laboring doing it, because it was associated with slavery.
Hmm.
And so,
they outsourced that labor.
They outsourced it. Even if they were pretty broke, they would outsource.
Hmm.
So it's a kind of cross-class thing that happened where Black women had a monopoly on doing everybody's laundry. And they used it for their power. You know, so there's the famous Atlanta strike in 1881 when there's an exposition that the washerwomen organize and get better rights based on the fact that the whole city will need extra stuff done. Mm-hmm. But it was amazing, and it's a beautiful book by Tara Hunter called To Join My Freedom, which chronicles that. And so when I went to write about the washerwomen, I was like, I hope there's something else. Mm-hmm. And boy, there was just so much. The Atlantic example was just one mm-hmm. of numerous examples. My favorite was in 1865.
Right after the end of the war.
Moment of emancipation. Mm-hmm. The women in Jackson, Mississippi organized a union and set terms for a living wage, when they will not do laundry, when they will do laundry,
wow.
and where they'll do it.
Mm-hmm.
And so, it's just extraordinary
mm-hmm.
To see that confidence and that power that they felt, even in a moment of vulnerability.
Like real uncertainty, yeah. Mm-hmm. And they also had a lot of autonomy. Like, it wasn't a well-paying job, but mm-hmm. Black women got to work by themselves, amongst themselves. They got to talk to each other. So a lot of Black women, you're right, preferred those jobs because it was better than being a live-in maid for a white person.
So, the shift toward freedom is such a powerful one, because in enslavement, Black women don't really have good autonomy over their households.
Mm-hmm.
And they particularly don't get to raise their own kids.
Right.
And so they would be taken from them, they would have to set them somewhere when they were infants under a tree and hope they would be okay.
Mm-hmm.
And so in freedom, Black women wanna raise their kids, mm-hmm. especially their young ones, preschool age. And so taking in laundry and doing that work in their own yards and at their own homes enabled their kids to be in that space, mm-hmm. and that they would be safe. And women could train their daughters to do that work mm-hmm. as they grew up. And so it became like a small family enterprise
mm-hmm.
That they could undertake on their own.
Mm-hmm.
And they could stay away from white households, where a lot of Black women who did domestic labor were extremely vulnerable to sexual assault
mm-hmm.
from men who felt like that was their right to rape and hurt Black women if they were in their houses. So
mm-hmm.
laundresses opting out of doing laundry in white homes was a huge negotiating
mm-hmm.
Tactic that they used their power to get.
It's fascinating to think about the different ways that white ideas about Black sexuality inform the labor, right? So like the Pullman porters worked on the cars, but they were not allowed to assist white women on the cars,
yes.
right? Because of this fear that Black men
mm-hmm.
are threats to white women, right?
Absolutely.
And also, the washerwomen were seen as basically unrapeable, right?
Yes.
Because they were Black women. And that shaped the reason why they gravitated toward that labor as opposed to domestic labor.
Yes, absolutely. So that the mythology about being in fear of Black men
mm-hmm.
was flipped on its head. The people who needed protection were Black women because they were extremely vulnerable, and Black men needed protection from the accusations and that carried a death sentence
mm-hmm.
for them. And so Pullman porters had to be extremely cautious about being on the cars with white passengers. There were Pullman maids, Black women who were hired to wait on white women on trains if there was a special need. They weren't on every car, but
mm-hmm.
they were part of the ranks of the Pullman porters and the Brotherhood
mm-hmm.
as well. So those sexual mythologies that Ida B. Wells writes so beautifully about really do come into play in the lives of working Black people.
Mm-hmm. This book is, on one hand, it's a book of history, right? Obviously,
yeah.
you're trying to lay out the history of Black laborers. But in another way, it's like a genealogical story. It's a story of your family.
It is.
And you tell the story of Henry Rucker. Can you tell us about how you found him and who he was?
So Henry is the farthest back relative on my mother's side that I can find in the historical records by name.
Mm-hmm.
And he was born either in Virginia or in Georgia. Either he was born in Virginia and brought physically when the family moved from Virginia to Georgia, or was born there.
Hmm.
Can't tell. But I can see him through his life. I can find who I believe he is on the slave censuses. Slave censuses were documents that tracked the number of property and enslaved people. So that slaveholders held prior to the 1860 census. And so they would list people by color, mulatto or black, by age, and by sex. And so I can track him on that census, who I believe he is. He was listed as mulatto in every census after freedom. And so there's a mulatto slave that's his exactly his age that I see in the slave census, who I believe is him.
Mm-hmm.
I also happened to find him in his owner's will, which historian me was taught that, you know, most slaves are not listed by name in wills.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was like, I'm not gonna read this long document. You know, he's not in there, you're gonna get disappointed. And something was prompting me, and something was like, read it, read it anyway. So it was like 2 a.m. I was like, yeah, I'll just turn on some music and listen.
And work your way through as well.
And just read through. And then I was reading and reading and reading, and I see an H, a big giant H. And I was like, dang, that says Henry? And it said Henry, a blacksmith. And he was giving Henry to a particular son who must have needed some help, sort of infrastructure help. And so I found him in the will. And then I found him voting in 1867. His slave owner dies in the midst of the Civil War of old age and probably stress. And so in 1867, I find him registering to vote with an X. And above it, it says his mark.
What was it about Henry that he would have been in the will, though?
So, you know, skilled slaves, as they were called, you know, were prized. So if you were a blacksmith, if you were a carpenter, if you were a mason, a bricklayer, you were thought of, if you were a cook, if you were a musician, you had cachet. And you could sometimes earn some money on the side for yourself if your slaveholder wanted you to have a little bit more autonomy. Sometimes you could be sold to other people, like rented out to do certain jobs, and whole slaveholders would keep the money. But they might have a bit more mobility, a little bit more autonomy. But what was really striking to me is that Henry's family wasn't in the will with him. His wife and his children were unmentioned and unnamed. And so if his will had been executed prior to the end of the war, I wondered, you know, would his family have been dispersed?
So it's, I mean, there's this weird paradox there, because Henry is capital, right? He's literal property.
Absolutely.
But he's also labor, right? Like, and we think of those things as different, but when it comes to black people in the United States, they've always been kind of the same thing.
Yeah, and for me, I start in slavery. You know, I guess a traditional history wouldn't start in slavery because they're not a free working class, right? They don't have a sort of, you know, a traditional framework of a Marxian class. But for me, what the black working class become and who they are and how they identify and how they build solidarity with one another comes from enslavement, because it is such a stressful and distressing experience to get taken from a place, taken from language, taken from family and community, and have to remake that over and over and over again. Those are powerful habits that people develop, and a powerful ethic and a way of seeing the world and a critique of the world and a critique of this country that they build as enslaved people. That undergirds who they become as a free people.
So you like you write about that period as like the beginning of a black class consciousness.
So there's not much slavery in the book. Sometimes people ask me a lot about slavery, and I'm like, it's not a slavery book. Like half a chapter. But it's the roots. It really is the beginnings of where people come from. And finding Henry and thinking through Henry for me was a powerful way to take it from sort of this abstract past that we, that, you know, we all think about, to really thinking about an individual and the things he went through, the things he suffered, the things he was able to make and do and build and pass down.
Who was Solicitor Duncan? That's a dope name, though. So I know. That's such a dope name.
That's my great grandfather.
Mm-hmm.
And Solicitor, not only did he have a cool name, he also had this like ethic of naming his kids words that sounded like initials so that people would not call them like by their first name. So like I mentioned my uncle OB.
OB, yeah.
There was ST, you know, he went through, John D was, so he was like JD, mm-hmm. you know, so that white men wouldn't call them by their first name. And I think he liked solicitor because it sounded like a title.
It's like a title, right?
Yeah, mm-hmm. so he was really into like,
all the old black men like colonel and master, and like they, white people had to call them by the name. It's like, oh, you're gonna call me sergeant, or you're gonna call yeah. me, yeah, exactly.
So he was resistant mm-hmm. in his habits, even around naming his children. But solicitor was my great grandfather. He was a minister in his community in Comer, Georgia, mm-hmm. And he runs away from sharecropping when my grandfather is 14 years old. And escapes Comer, Georgia in the middle of the night after being told he was owed, that he owed the landholder after a year mm-hmm. of, you know, raising the crop and growing the crop. And he knew there should have been some money coming back to mm-hmm. him. And
he had no recourse. You can't be like,
no,
you can't. You're lying, give me my money.
No, yeah. You can't fight.
He could get lynched, yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So he just knew he had to run. So he packed up the whole entire family in the nighttime. And that story of my grandfather's family escaping sharecropping is a story that I was told by my grandfather, by my grandmother, by my mother, mm-hmm. over and over again. It was sort of like the...
It's like a foundational myth.
It's the origin story of my family.
Mm-hmm. What happened to Solicitor once he moved?
So Solicitor takes his family to Thomasville.
Mm-hmm.
And then he settles in the mountains of North Carolina, and he becomes a minister there. He died in a car accident mm. when my mom was really little, but she had a chance to know him and meet him and spend time with him in the summer when she would be sent south. And so, you know, I have this fuzzy picture of someone holding a picture of him up. that's pretty amazing.
That's amazing. Yeah. You and I talked about this, not to get too personal, but you and I talked about considering ourselves working class black folks who are no longer in that social location neatly, right? Like, mm-hmm. We grew up in black spaces, black networks, and working black people, and we are not that now, right?
Yeah.
And because I'm working through this myself, and I'm curious about how you think about this, because our kids will have even more distance from those spaces.
Mm-hmm.
How are you affirming this like black working class identity for children who are a couple like orders removed from it?
For me, it's really about thinking about the ethic that the working class held. That we, you know, that building a little wealth and having a home and having some property and hopefully having some land and mm-hmm. those kinds of things, those are the things that my ancestors wanted.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't want to be hemmed into this sort of tight space. So having those things is a fulfillment of the work that they did.
Mm-hmm.
And it comes from something different. You know, in America, we're often thinking of, you know, achievement as a very individual exploit that, mm-hmm. you know, I'm really great and I individual lift myself up and I became a great person because I'm essentially great. And they, you know, people don't like to give a lot of credit to other people or mm-hmm. to community or mentors or networks.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, I want my children to see all the spaces that are lifting and affirming them intergenerationally and in their own generation, and that to build those networks is what it means to carry the ethic of these folks mm-hmm. forward through time. And so I want them to be in those institutions. I stay in institutions in my community that mm-hmm. let them see that
mm-hmm.
and let them know that, you know, the church I go to, there are postal workers and CNAs and CEOs and lawyers and mm-hmm. doctors and janitors.
Mm-hmm.
And we are all leaders and we are all valued and we're all the same kind of voices in that space. And I just want them to learn that intuitively, that they're not to look down on somebody as if they are above,
mm-hmm.
because we're all one fabric.
It's actually really hard to talk about class distinctions with black folks sometimes because
it doesn't work.
The proximity is so PG County, up until fairly recently, right? PG County just outside of DC, up until recently was the wealthiest majority black county in the United States, but also has a poverty rate in the low teens, right? So it was like this proximity, this real proximity between black wealth,
mm-hmm.
you know, whatever that means, and like concentrated black poverty. And so it was very hard to sort of figure out like where the lines
are. And all those people are related.
All related to each other. Like, you have like physical like proximity, but you have like familial proximity, social proximity. So, right?
Yes.
You go to your church, you go to the same hairdressers, right?
Yes.
And it's been really, like, one of the reasons I was so excited for this book was that I find it, we have a really hard time sort of pulling these things apart, you know what I mean?
Yes, and you know, that when, even when black folks in our generation are doing extremely well, there are people who we're sending money to.
Absolutely.
There are people who are educating, there are people
right.
who were.
I pay my mom's rent, I pay all the bills, like, money is not going to my savings, it's like, I'm supporting my family.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so it's just a different experience.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's a fine thing. I think that's what our ancestors wanted.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. what do you think we miss about when we tell the story of the working class in America, right? Every 4 years is about to happen next year, guarantee it.
Oh, yeah, it's gonna be fun.
I know. I'm working in news in election year. but next year, everybody's gonna descend on the diners in the Midwest and talk about the white working class and the things they're concerned about. Like, what are we gonna, like, what stories about the black working class are we missing?
You know, one of the reasons why I admired my my president at large, as I call her, Stacey Abrams, is that she had such a vision. She grew up working class. She understood her state, her home. And so she applied that to Georgia and went to rural places and talked to working people, because she knew that working class black people care a lot about politics.
Mm-hmm.
And they're engaged. They're more, measurably more engaged than any other working class in the United States.
Mm-hmm.
And so she went to them and she organized it, and she showed the flex that community can have and change what we thought of Georgia to be.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, it's still there. It's still sticking.
Mm-hmm.
In how that state is now organized, in spite of efforts to suppress black votes, mm-hmm. active efforts to prevent you from having a water online
mm-hmm.
handed to you from someone. So I just want the country to keep thinking bigger about what working classes are.
Mm-hmm.
And that if we talk to the black working class, if we talk to Latinx communities, if we talk to all these different spaces, we get a different and broader perspective on what working people need. And if we can have a broad cross-race conversation about class, but that centers the questions that my ancestors were thinking about,
mm-hmm.
you start to ask really important questions.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think, you know, race has been used in our politics as a grand distraction
mm-hmm.
for generations.
Absolutely.
And it still is. And so by just pushing that camera lens out, it doesn't have to be like, oh, it's not the white working class, it's only the black working class.
Mm-hmm.
No, and coalitions are necessary. But boy, if you think differently and more broadly, you end up with a whole new set of questions that you might want to ask of voters.
Mm-hmm. If I can back up a little bit to the
Pullman
Porters. the Pullman Porters is like a mild obsession of mine. We named our son after A. Philip Randolph. Like,
oh, you
again,
did?
Yeah. It's just like, they're, you know, they're just like at the center of a lot of our fascinations and our values, right? But they were the first, you know, black labor union to be federally recognized.
Yes.
What happened to those black labor unions? Like, or what happened to them after?
Well, you know, the trains go away
mm-hmm.
in the way that we know them with the advent of airplanes.
Mm-hmm.
But the legacy of what the Pullman Porters do is really incredible.
Mm-hmm.
So after they're organized in the late 1930s, mm-hmm. they don't really turn their efforts to keep improving the porters' lives. They're consistent on that.
Mm-hmm.
But what they do is they really build a civil rights organization.
Mm-hmm.
And they use that platform to argue for access for black federal employment, equal access. They start what they call the March on Washington movement
mm-hmm.
in the 1930s.
So like several decades before King, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah, so the March on Washington, the reason you see A. Philip Randolph in that footage standing mm-hmm. at the center is that that's still his movement.
Mm-hmm.
And he's used the power of black working people to undergird what they do in 1963.
Mm-hmm.
Right across the street, I guess.
Right across the street, yeah. I guess we're turning to questions though, is that? We have five more minutes, okay. One of the things that is so fascinating about this book is we're talking about a class of people who were brought here as laborers, right?
Yes.
Although never compensated for,
no.
you know, for the first several centuries. And then who are also in all of our discourse framed as lazy, mm-hmm. right? As people who do not work, right? It informs our policy, our priorities to this day, right? Mm-hmm. The affirmative action discourse is shaped by sort of the idea of undeserving because, you know, lack of merit, right? Mm-hmm. Welfare
Social
policy
welfare. Yep,
is
absolutely.
The big one, right? Can you sort of talk about like the sort of long legacy of that paradox of like black people being integral workers to the construction of
America? Yeah, in the book, I pick on Thomas Jefferson because, you know, I went to
as
UVA.
She went to UVA.
So it's a sport, honey. I love picking apart Thomas Jefferson.
He's easy to pick apart.
Yeah, he is.
He's kind of trash.
And he was, and grown more trash as
time. We learned that there are more layers.
Because when
trash.
I went to, you know, when I was at UVA, Sally Hemings was a scurrilous rumor.
Whoa.
Exactly. So it was quite a surreal.
He had a whole family. Oh, wow. Yeah.
I wrote a paper. You know, I wrote a paper called "Thomas Jefferson, Father and Master," and I turned it in for one of my history classes. I got the lowest grade, and they were like, "This is a pamphlet of lies." I was like, "Okay, pamphlet of lies." So
I remember. So the first time we ever met was actually at Monticello. I don't remember this. We bumped into random
yes,
at Monticello
we
randomly.
Were. That was wild.
And I remember there was a story, and this is like one of the reasons like Thomas Jefferson's trash, but like there was a story about how that he had a playmate, a black playmate who was, you know, a slave boy, mm-hmm. and how Thomas Jefferson famously had money problems. And at some point, this little boy who was like one of his closest friends, he sold him, you know, to, you know, I was like, oh, you are, I mean, granted the institution itself was like dehumanizing, but
yes.
you are a villain. Yeah. Anyway, sorry.
But also a great founding father. Oh, important God, documents.
Anyway.
But so I use a bit of the notes on the state of Virginia to sort of, because for me, he's sort of the progenitor of thinking about black life and rationalizing slavery. Mm-hmm. And so the notes on the state of Virginia are a set of letters he writes to a French friend of his. To explain America. Mm-hmm. And so in that section, he's talking about enslaved people. And, you know, he says that they keep falling asleep after they work, basically. You know, I'm like, yes,
could you
yes,
imagine?
Sir. You Wait, woke them up at dawn and Absolutely. Worked them until dusk. And mm-hmm. yeah, they might take a nap.
Mm-hmm.
And he's, you know, he's like, they don't think their griefs are transient is one mm-hmm. of my favorite sentences.
Yeah.
And so
he's saying that they don't feel pain.
They don't feel pain, they're lazy. They're not like us. Mm. They're fundamentally a different creature than white Americans. And so it was, you know, the seeds of that thought that you could sit in a chair built by enslaved people, in a room built by enslaved people, on land cleared by enslaved people, and look out of through a window made by an enslaved man, and look at them and say they're lazy.
Mm.
It's powerful.
Mm.
But okay.
I mean, there's a million reasons why that's so sticky, but can you talk about why that thing endures, that idea endures?
I think, you know, in Accomack County, where one of my ancestors is from, mm-hmm. and I write about a labor movement, and the people around the turn of the 20th century are trying to say, we deserve a certain amount of money, mm-hmm. we prefer to not work for other people, we want our own land, we want to work for black landholders if we can. If we can't, we'll, you know, this is our set wage. And in the New York Times, they were like, this is laziness.
Mm.
They don't want to work. So when black people extend market principles to their own lives, they are lazy.
Mm-hmm.
And these are the principles that we say as a country are super important. That, you know, you should barter for the best sets of conditions. You should negotiate when you get a job. You know, there's all kinds of things that we're telling people.
Mm-hmm.
But when black working people did those things, that was marked as laziness. And so it's really kind of a profound world upside down that keeps happening,
mm-hmm.
I think, for black folks.
We're gonna open the floor to questions?
Absolutely.
This was a great conversation. And,
Kelly is my married name. They're from Fayetteville, North Carolina, so those are my cousins there. Solicitor Duncan was his name. Mm-hmm. Oh, thank you. I think there's a mic.
Oh, is there?
There she comes.
Hello.
Hi, I'm from Detroit. And I was wondering, did you write? I just got your book, so I haven't opened
it. I didn't write, okay. I was just telling Gene, I proposed a much longer book than this one. And then as I wrote it, I was like, oh, this is long. And this is full. And it you know, covers the lifetime of like my grandfather's generation. And so I had a whole auto workers, Detroit. I had ship fitters and Navy Yards. I had all kinds of stuff that was proposed. And I was like, it doesn't fit. You know, it's just not going, people are not going to want to read a 500-600 page book. And so I was like, I have to stop. But I want to write another book. And for me, Detroit will be a huge part of it because Detroit really tells the story of the working class in a very particular kind of way. Mm-hmm. Both the coming of this power and the ways in which, declining values that are given to black land and black homes really undercuts what Detroiters are able to build and through their organizations and through their really powerful unions. And so Detroit for me will be the center of my next book, which I haven't written yet, but I'm excited about writing.
Take a breath real quick.
Yeah, maybe a week.
Yeah.
if you do anything on black women around World War II, Rosie the Riveter, the bomber plant where they worked, that plant was segregated. Nobody talks about that. That, you know, women moved into the plant, started working because men went to war and everybody.
I do write about that. There's a chapter about black women who are doing domestic work. I focus on Philadelphia where my grandmother was doing domestic work. And the explosion of black women doing domestic work during that time period is because white women are leaving households and need help. Raising their kids all of a sudden as becoming a working population for the first time. And so I talk about the way that Rosie the Riveter had a black maid.
But they had to force themselves into that.
Absolutely, mm-hmm. Absolutely. Very few black women were given opportunities for defense jobs. And A. Philip Randolph was a big part of the numbers who did get those access. Okay, then.
That's what's up.
Absolutely.
That's what's up.
We have other questions. We're going to station the mic back here if you want to come up and ask your question.
So if you want to go to the back, you want them to go to the back.
You want to shout it?
Shout it.
Come on.
You got to shout louder now.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And just to repeat her question, she asked about the Great Migration to the North. She said she learned about a lot about that in school, but she wanted to know a little bit more about the Great Migration to the West, and you actually talk about that.
Yeah, I actually have the story of some Texans who moved to California that are in black folk. And you know, people's migration routes were set by trains. And so where the train went, that's where people tended to go. So, Eastern Shore of Virginia, Maryland, where my family is from, that train went dead to Philadelphia. So there's this massive community of Eastern Shore folks in Philadelphia. In Detroit, those folks tend to be from Middle South, so Louisiana, Mississippi was Chicago, Texas was California. And so depending on those train routes is how people follow those migratory patterns. And by doing it a few times, you know, then you go because your cousin's there, and you go because your uncle's there, and you know, it sets up. So people tended not to be just randomly choosing cities, but really choosing whether they could afford to take the train and go really easily. And so, like my students that I've taught in North Carolina, you know, I say, well, you know, do you have folks who migrated? And they're all like, New Jersey, New York. You know, no one's like LA or, you know, unless they're from out of town. But if they're from North Carolina, that's where their northern relatives are. So those trains really set the pattern. Oh, yay. Well, come take my class in spring.
Hi, thank you. Just to follow up on what you were just saying, my family started off in North Carolina, as my wife's did as well, and then migrated up to Baltimore and Philadelphia. And I guess my question is, as you indicated, once your family got up there and wrote back home saying, come on up, it's okay, like, that makes sense. But the first folks that went up, did your research show that they did so with trepidation, or they were just so happy to get the hell out of there that they couldn't wait to go?
One of my favorite stories in the book is, and I don't know if I've talked about, a woman named Minnie who was from, Minnie Savage, who was from Accomack County, where my grandfather was from. My grandfather left as a teenager in Accomack, and Minnie did probably left within a year or two of him. I don't know that they knew each other, but they both followed that same route. Mm-hmm. And Minnie basically ran away from her parents because they didn't want her to go, and they wanted her to stay and continue to work. And she was like, I have got to go. So she pretended to go to a church event and then said she was feeling sick and snuck off and hopped on the train. And she said when the train stopped in Maryland, she hid because she didn't know if her father was going to like ride alongside the train looking for her. And she hid and she went and she just walked, you know, no suitcase, and moved to Philadelphia as a teenager. So it's, you know, she's an unusual version of a migration story, but I thought, you know, an important one to capture the spirit of, you know, people who just wanted out and they wanted to see if they could do something different. When she got there, it was really hard. You know, she kind of regretted moving and thinking it was going to be a complete change for her, because it really wasn't. She was put to work as a maid and forced to wash floors on her hands and knees in a drugstore. And you know, that's kind of demeaning treatment that she wasn't expecting. She wanted a break from being demeaned, and she still found it in Philadelphia.
Good afternoon, Blair.
Hey.
Oh, I think it's still morning. 11:51. So, congratulations.
Thank you.
And then I wanted to know, what about your journey as you were doing writing the book? What did changed about you, about your perspective and how you approach writing? And I know you mentioned that you had to cut off some chapters, but I really want to hear about your perspective as the author.
You know, so this is not my first book. I wrote a book called Ride to Ride, and I wrote it really as a historian. It was a story that interests me in history that hadn't been amplified, and it was a civil rights protest that happens, you know, 50 years prior to the traditional civil rights movement. And I was inspired by those people, and I loved writing that book, but it was like a regular history book. I think it's readable, but it really wasn't written to be in conversation with other people. It was written to be in conversation with other historians. And so in the process of writing Black Folk, I felt so empowered to tell a story in a way that could be transformative to people who maybe don't read a lot of history, but who are excited to know more about the past. And to write it in ways that were you know, beautiful and artful was a huge part of like how I like to write and how I like to think about telling a story. And so the space that I got from sort of a non-traditional historical space to write creatively and thoughtfully about things that are true, it's real history, but I wanted to bring that lyricism to a history that I think has often been missing from the way that trained historians have written. Oftentimes, you know, people's favorite history books aren't written by people with history training. They're just people who love history and write really well and then end up researching and telling a great story.
The Warmth of the Suns.
The Warmth of the Suns is a really great example. It's a transformative book for so many people. I just wanted to bring, you know, a historian's vision to that kind of transformative writing. So Yeah, she's a role model for me.
She's
incredible.
And it's like one of the most impressive books I've ever read.
I was on Twitter and I was like, what's your favorite history book? And One of the Sons blew everybody
up. Yeah, of course.
I was like, you know.
Mm-hmm. It was like a book that it's about the Great Migration. And it's just like and she tells it through the stories of three different black folks going to different parts of the country. She's a scarily good writer. And so it's like this, she's bringing all of that magic to bear on these stories that are overlooked. And you realize that the story of black workers and black migrants is this epic, it feels like an adventure in her hands, you know what I mean?
Yes.
Like these people are going off to these foreign lands that are in the same country, right?
Yes.
Essentially, right?
Yes.
And it also just made like so many small things make sense. I had this boy named Latone, he's from Chicago, from the South Side. Mm-hmm. And I used to always clown him like, bro, you are so country. And I just realized like, because straight from Mississippi, his people would have been straight from Mississippi. That's why he had that drawl, that twang,
yes,
right?
Yes.
My ex-girlfriend was from Detroit, her family had the same thing, right? It was like, oh, this is a story about us still.
Yes, yeah. So I wanted to capture that same spirit. And I think a lot of times historians haven't worried about that.
Mm-hmm.
But it's such a gift to me to hear from audiences and to hear people's, you know, work lives and family lives and hear about folks' grandmothers and have a different understanding of their own lives, mm-hmm. vis-a-vis these conversations and this book. So it feels like an incredible gift. So I'm excited about what comes next.
Just be loud.
Did somebody at the mic, let the person at the mic go. My friends from UVA.
Oh, what's good?
Hi, Doc. I really appreciate the conversation that you're having. It was really intriguing. But I want to piggyback off of what someone else said about migrating to the South migrating from the South to the West, and how you mentioned the migration from North Carolina to Philly and the treatment that woman was receiving that you mentioned as a precursor. I'm from LA, so I'm kind of curious. For the migration piece, migrating from the South to further west, like LA and either areas on that side of the United States, do you think it was still the same treatment of people who are migrating? Because I often hear that, yeah, it's still racism, it's still discrimination, but it's less discreet, but it's not like the South.
Yeah, I think most migrants experience a transformation, both to the West, but to Philadelphia, and there's a great letter that I had from a migrant to, he was writing to the Chicago Defender, mm-hmm. and he said, you know, I can sit anywhere I want on the streetcar, I can walk on any sidewalk and no one asks me to jump off, I can drink from any water fountain, my kids are in school every day. And so, you know, it was a transformation because so many people are coming from rural places where those things were not true, mm-hmm. and they were constantly demeaned. So much so that they had to try to keep their kids out of public spaces, lest they just feel devastated on a daily basis. And so I think it's important to note that it is a transformation to live in a society without legal segregation. But at the same time, you know, de facto segregation meant that those same black folks had to live in tight quarters and pay too much rent and be exploited on the job and be really limited to a small set of jobs. So yes, it's a transformation, and yes, it's better, but it's not the transformation they deserved.
And also, just to piggyback on the LA point, when black folks started landing in Los Angeles, when the LAPD was professionalizing, one of the things they did was actively recruit Klan members,
white Southerners,
from the South. And so the LAPD was like populated by some of the same white folks that black
folks. So it was the Oakland PD.
Yeah, Oakland PD too. I mean, mm-hmm. you can pick a police department in California and you can find a similar
South,
story.
White Southern.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes. So that's a part of the story too, is that the same sort of white antagonists follow black folks out there.
Hi, I just wanted to share that last month I got a chance to visit Monticello, and it was very interesting, but I want to let everyone in this room know that they are now sharing the history of Sally Hemings, and they also have a section on Mulberry Row, which is where enslaved people resided and the work that they did, and they are telling the truth about what has happened. So if you get a chance to go to Monticello, please take a look at the Mulberry Roll and the Sally Hemings exhibit. They are really doing a good job with this. It was the best
part. It's a dramatic transformation from when I was in college.
And getting bad grades on papers.
Yeah, my mother took me to Monticello for my graduation week, and they were talking about servants, and they were saying that more Africans were taken to South America than to North America. She's like, but we're here. And so she started like yelling at the docent, like on the front lawn, because she was so angered, and she started talking about Sally Hemings, and they were looking at her like. So yes, there's been quite a transformation, but there's more work to be done.
Yes.
In all these spaces, in Monticello, in a lot of the sort of presidential spaces.
Mount Vernon, oh.
Yeah, Mount Vernon. And for me, the work of centering descendant communities, my student Hannah Scruggs, who works here at the Smithsonian, is a leader in the question of how do we center Black descendants in these conversations about how transformation must take place. And so we need to really do substantive work to make sure all those spaces aren't just sort of finally mentioning us, but also centering our lives, because our lives were at the center of those spaces.
Mm-hmm. And not to big up Monticello too much, but we went to the slave tour there.
Yeah.
And it was fascinating. Like the guy who was giving the tour was like, what we're not gonna do is we're not gonna ignore a lot of this stuff. He's like, so he just basically tried to cut off all the avenues of inquiry, right? To sort of be like, well, maybe Jefferson wasn't that bad a guy. He's like, so here's what we know about the Hemingses, right? Like they had children together, and the conditions of their relationship meant that she had no legal rights. So she could not, like, if you're thinking about them as like, oh, maybe they had a consensual relationship, remember that she could not legally consent. So like, the context in which we're having this conversation has to like sit with these facts. And so he was like, you can ask any questions you want, but this is where we're starting. And I was like, okay, bro, we about to get into this. It was not to big up Monticello so much, but they actually have made a really concerted effort to like sit with this.
And they can keep going.
Yeah.
It's my understanding they started this going back to 2018, and I was impressed with the way
he and I were there when they re-kicked.
Mm-hmm.
They had a conference, and they had different people speaking, and they have a lot of transformation in there.
They were specifically trying to tie Monticello to, I think this was not long after, they were tying it to Ferguson. I think it was like, they were trying to like, this is a straight line from that moment in history to the moment we're living through. Mm-hmm.
But they can keep going.
Yeah, exactly.
Can I have the one last question? So the resources that we have to study Black families are growing exponentially. The work that they do here at the Smithsonian and the Family History Center is really incredible as a resource and support. I turned to them to verify the work I had done in preparation for the book, just to make sure I wasn't crazy or missing something. And so that was an incredible sort of full circle moment to go to my student and to make sure like, okay, let's look at my census together. But the materials on ancestry.com are really powerful things, and they're gathering so much stuff. So, there's a critique of Ancestry that can be mounted, and yet I think it's an amazing tool for us to do a lot of work. And so a lot of census documents, death certificates, wills are things that are loaded in there, those slave schedules that I talked about, that really give you a quick and expansive look at a past. If you have a few facts about those names and the things you want to trace. And so it's not complete. We were not centered in in archival records from the past because we were were thought of as property. But there are really interesting ways to dig into that if you're interested that weren't available to us. I have 26 trees in Ancestry because I use them as a quick tool to understand a lot about a name or a person that I you know otherwise can't see without a lot of footwork. In my first book, I didn't have any technology at all, and I was rolling census documents on microfilm and reading newspapers day by day, which was wonderful because it gave me a certain kind of perspective, but it's just much slower, much harder. So the advancement in that technology is really powerful.
There's one more question. That's one more question.
Last question.
Okay. Bye. Thank you so much for just explaining your journey. I'm just curious, what was the time frame? I mean, I know you started with the stories, you know, that you were sharing, but the book is, I haven't read it, but it sounds very rich. How long did it take?
So I started working on my family history right before my mother died. My mother died about 10 years ago. So a couple years before her passing, I began to work on my ancestry tree. So that the root of that is there. But I was just doing it for like fun. Like I would just be like, oh, I'm gonna stop working and play in Ancestry. And you know, stay up till like 3 or 4 in the morning, like figuring stuff out and putting it on Twitter and like, woo, look at this. But then I got invited to think about the question of the Black working class in 2019. And so then all those things began to really come together. And then the pandemic hit, shutting down a lot of the archival things mm-hmm. that you could normally go do. But because I had the genealogy, I just kept making it more and more of the story, that work I had already done. And so, since 2019, been on the grind writing Black folk, but I'm just really excited to see. And the pandemic helped me, you know, have a few moments of just, you know, staying home and using that time that I was using on commuting and doing other outside things for writing Black folk while I was still a full-time faculty member. So it's been a labor of love and of joy for me. And so I'm just so thrilled to have people read.
Thank you so much for writing the doc, seriously.
Thank you. Thank you for being in a conversation with me.
Oh, come on. It's an honor, seriously.
Yeah. My Philly family.
Your Philly family.
Let us thank once again Dr. Kelley and Gene Demby for this wonderful conversation that we've had this morning. We are so grateful. I will say that Dr. Kelley will be upstairs in Heritage Hall signing books. If you have not purchased a book, you can purchase a book in our bookstore. They're on the first floor, so please meet her up there in the next, give her, you know, 10 minutes, and we'll have her up there to sign books, and we encourage continued conversation while you are here. Thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you.